Rev up your engine!
Well, Toyota's got a newer SUV out there called the Toyota Corolla Cross. Now, they're starting to sell them in Thailand. They're going to sell them in the United States. And if you know a little bit about history, you'll understand that 1988 to 1992, Toyota sold a Corolla Alltrack. It was a four-wheel drive Toyota Corolla. Now, they didn't sell that many of them, but they're very popular in places like Colorado where people skied. And now, basically, they're taking Corolla frame and they're making the small SUV called the Corolla Cross. It'll be smaller than the RAV4, so it'll be a smaller SUV. It's got a lot of room inside. It's got 15.5 cubic feet of space inside. Now, in Thailand, as they have it now, it's going to have one of two engines. A 1.8 liter that's just a plain old four-cylinder that puts out 140 horsepower and uses a CVT. And the other one is a 1.8 Atkinson cycle engine, a hybrid. It's such a crowded market, though, these smaller SUVs. They're simplifying their designs. They're taking bases like the Corolla and they're building things on it. Originally, the Toyota Matrix was called the Toyota Corolla Matrix because basically it was a Corolla with a different body on it and a different kind of suspension system, too. But they're, rather than making a billion different things, make a platform and then put on it what people want to buy. Years ago, when they're talking about hydrogen fuel cell cars, that was one of the selling points was, look, these things are going to cost over $100,000, so we'll have a skateboard platform, that there's the platform, and then every so many years, you could just change the body style, bolt it on, so it looks like you have a different car if you're bored with looking at the car. They knew Americans get bored. They're basically doing the Toyota, only you can't replace the parts and put a different body on them, but they are putting the different bodies on the same basic framework. Not a bad idea, really, you know. People want certain style, great. And if that style goes out, they can dump that style and put a different style on top of that same basic body. Now, here's a bit of interesting technology. Hyundai is making a real manual transmission with a hand shifter and six speeds, but it doesn't use a clutch pedal. Ages ago, Volkswagen had that stick shift automatic, which didn't have a clutch pedal either. It was a really cheesy design. It shifted up and down, and when you went to shift, you take your foot off the gas, and when you pull it, take your foot off the gas, there was a centrifugal weight, and that worked as the clutch so you could shift gears. Things have gotten so much more complex that this six-speed one is computer setup. It's not just some simple weight that a torque makes it slide open, and then when you put it in gear, it pops back in. The car has a clutch that is automated. The transmission, with computer sensors, can tell when you're about to shift. It has what they call an intention sensor, tells the control unit to hydraulically activate the clutch. So it has an actual clutch. It isn't some swinging weight that works like a foot. It's a hydraulic clutch and the computer engages it, and then you shift the gear and it puts it back in. And it also keeps people from destroying their car. Because let's say you're in sixth gear and you're on a highway. If you try ramming that thing into second gear, the computer sees what you're doing and it won't allow you to do it. Because it gets wheel speed, transmission speed, all kinds of stuff. And it won't let you blow the engine up. Now, they're going to try this thing out first in India in what they call a Venue, which is a 1.2 liter turbocharged engine. So here, they're being smart. Because for ages, that's what Toyota and Honda did. They tested their vehicles out in smaller markets. Honda, for example, tested all their fuel injection and stuff, a lot of it in Great Britain, which is a smaller market. And once they perfected it, they brought it to the United States. Then it didn't ruin people's taste by a system that didn't work. Honda's fuel injection systems were pretty bulletproof when they started selling in the United States. Who knows? Maybe they'll get the setup right so that you can have a standard transmission and you just don't have to push on a clutch pedal. Done by computers instead. But to me, what's the big deal? I learned how to drive on a Chevrolet that was an automatic, and then my first car was an Opel that was a standard. I think it took me 10 minutes to figure out to use a clutch. Once you already know how to drive, it's not that big of a deal using a clutch pedal. You know, everything's becoming modernized, and if they want to have the computer activate the clutch instead of your foot, they can go right ahead. We'll see if this goes into mass production or if it's like a one-off thing that people just say, they can have all this computer stuff and stick it in right. Still, with a clutch pedal, it's a lot simpler, a lot less things to go wrong, and if you're stuck in the mud, you can play with the gears a lot better. You get a better feel than a computer that's guessing. So, I don't know. I think this is going to be a failure. Only time will tell if Scotty's right or not, but I don't see this as being something that's really going to be a big hit. Vazza says, I got a Ford Fusion, and third gear, it slams into gear. Some people say, maybe I need a torque converter. What do you think? Here's how you can diagnose most automatic transmission. If you got a torque converter problem, it's going to have problems in all the gears because it makes it shift all the gears. If it only slams into third gear, it means that you got a problem in the actual mechanical part of third gear. The gear's wearing out, the clutch, the third gear, something is wearing out in there. Pray that it's a shift solenoid. You might drop the pan, change the shift solenoid, put it in, put new fluid and filter, and pray, because those Fusions are notorious for having problems with their transmissions, and often it is the third gear going out. It's you can give the year if it's a really old one. Probably rebuilding the transmission is more money than the vehicle's worth, but it would be worthwhile to drop the pan, change the shift solenoid for third gear, and see what happens. It might fix it. But on the other hand, let's say you got 180,000 miles on it. I can just about guarantee you the transmission's going out. It's going to have to be rebuilt. Mark 2018 says, I jacked up my 95 Nissan Maxima. I thought the frame rail was strong enough. In the front it was. It jacked it up, but in the back, I crunched in. I quick put it down. Okay, did I hurt anything on this old thing? You probably bent a little bit, but that little bit probably isn't going to hurt anything. It's just that even back in 95, Nissan was starting to make them cheaper. And it's not a full frame. In the front, that rail was thick, but in the back it's thin and it just bends up. The back, you can't jack up there. You want to go to where the struts bolt on to the arm, any place where there's strong metal, and jack it up that way. You don't want to mess around with the back because the frame there is just too thin. It's what's called unibody construction. And for some reason, the front's a lot stronger, you can do it, but not the back. As long as you drive it and the tires aren't towed in and it doesn't shake when you're going, it doesn't hurt anything bending it that tiny little bit. But it's a lesson to be learned for anybody out there who wants to jack up a car. Always look out to see which is the strong part, which is the weak part. And if you don't know, don't start jacking up. Go to a different part that's obviously solid, like where a control arm comes off, bolts to the frame, where that big bolt is. It's almost always real easy to jack it up there. That's a real solid point. Or if you have tow hooks, you can use the tow hook as a jack point. That's real strong. You put the jack under that and jack it up that way. 202 Ray says, I got a question about my overdrive in my 05 Nissan Sentra. I drive in town most of the time and I never use it. So when should I use it? All right, overdrive is exactly what it says. It's to get better gas mileage. That's the only reason it's there. Now, you should just leave it on all the time. Who would even care? Because when you get to higher speeds, it would shift into overdrive. Now, if you live in a mountainous area or San Francisco, you may never use the overdrive because maybe it's just too steep and it'll never shift up into that top gear. And if you're towing something, well, what are you going to tow with a Sentra? It's not that big of an engine anyways. You could just turn it off. The only thing will happen is you'll get worse gas mileage because the engine will be spinning faster and everything wears out a little bit faster as it spins faster. The overdrive is to get better gas mileage and to wear the engine and transmission out less as time goes on. But of course it takes tens and tens of thousands of miles to do serious wear. Elliot wants us, Scotty, does the computer compensate for continuously dampening suspension as the struts age? I don't like waiting until my struts leak so I find a ride quality is going to be suffering even though they're not leaking. Well, the very expensive ones do to some extent because they get feedback of wheel speed, wheel hop, things like that, but not entirely because there's only so much feedback that the computer gets. Mainly it goes one way. It sees from the other what you click it on that you want to have it the smooth ride, so it sends the electricity, if it's a magnetic one, to make it thicker when you put it in race mode so it's stiffer, and then to make it thinner because then it doesn't send the electricity and the metallic fragments aren't floating around and make it act like a heavier fluid so it rides smoother. And I really don't think that they have feedback that it says, okay, now these things have 80,000 miles on it. You know, I don't think they've gone that far yet. Basically, you'd watch them, and if they're not leaking, hey, then they're going to be pretty well sealed, and there's no problem. The wear isn't going to be that much, and then when they do start leaking, then you're going to have to replace them for thousands of dollars a piece for the ones that I've worked on. They're not cheap systems to work on. They work great when they're new, but as they age, ooh-wee. I got customers with the older ones. Four struts cost more than a vehicle's worth. So a lot of guys then go and they go to like Monroe or someplace and they buy the replacement ones that aren't all electronic and they ride okay, but they cost so much less to put in when the fancy ones go out. Of course, the ride quality really suffers then. It won't ride nearly as well with plain ones than with the electronic ones. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.